Welcome to lecture series on Advanced Geotechnical Engineering offered by Indian Institute of Technology, IIT Bombay. This is a lecture which discusses about the entire course series which we have seen in 7 modules, and we try to look into the different areas which are there in the geotechnical engineering. And this course also has very well organized excellent material, basically to create an impetus and also a knowledge towards the geotechnical engineering aspects. So this is the course on Advanced Geotechnical Engineering, and this course actually has 7 modules, and in total about there are including this lecture, there will be about total 60 lectures. In module 1, we have discussed soil composition and soil structure, and basically we have tried to cover these lectures in length from L1 to L11, where the formation of the soil, types of soils and their characteristics were discussed, particle sizes and shapes and their impact on engineering properties, soil structure, that is the fabric arrangement, soil fabric, and clay mineralogy, and soil air water interaction, consistency of a soil, soil compaction, and concept of effective stress were discussed under the module 1. And this in this module we also have discussed about number of worked examples, and also solved number of problems which are pertinent to this module. So in module 2, the title of the module is permeability and seepage. In this module, the lectures were covered from L12 to L18, and the contents basically are a property of a soil, permeability, and a condition, seepage, were discussed in length, and seepage force and effective stress during seepage were discussed, and Laplace equations for one-dimensional and two-dimensional conditions, and insight for three-dimensional seepage was given, and flow net methods, conventional as well as the methods by using demonstration examples from the GeoStudio 2012 using CIPW program were also shown. And then also we discussed about anisotropic and non-homogeneous conditions, and confined and unconfined seepage conditions. And in this module, along with the theory, the number of worked examples have been solved, basically to give insight into this particular important module where the permeability and seepage are concerned. In module 3, the compressibility and consolidation, particularly these lectures are covered from L19 to L29, and wherein the stresses in soil from surface loads and Terjeghi's one-dimensional consolidation theory, and application in different boundary conditions, and especially the conventional Terjeghi's theory is instantaneous loading, but in case of ramp loading, how this can be done has been discussed, and determination of the coefficient of consolidation, also we discussed about the normal and over consolidated, normally and over consolidated soils, and compression curves, and secondary consolidation and radial consolidation. And then we introduced to the Barron's theory, and then thereafter the settlements of the compressible soil layers for one dimensional consolidation, as well as considering the one dimensional as well as the radial consolidation was discussed, and methods for accelerating consolidation settlements. Especially in this we discussed about preloading alone, and preloading with sand drains, and preloading with prefabricated vertical drains. And we also discussed about some novel methods like vacuum consolidation alone and vacuum consolidation along with prefabricated vertical drains. And these methods were basically to give insight into the methods for accelerating consolidation settlements, particularly the soils which are actually soft in nature, and when we require these the excess pore water pressure to be dissipated in a short duration of time. And this method was this particular concepts were really will be helpful. Then module 4, it deals with the stress strain relationship and shear strength characteristics of soils. And in this module, the lectures are covered from L30 to L39. And basically the stress state was introduced and Mohr circle analysis, particularly pole and principal stress spaces were discussed in length, stress paths in PQ space and Mohr Coulomb failure criteria and its limitations and the correlations with PQ space and stress strain behavior and isotropic compression and pressure dependency and confined compression and large stress compressions and definitions of failure and interlocking concept and its interpretations. And drainage conditions, especially with the triaxial behavior and connected with the stress paths for unconsolidated, undrained and unconfined compression test and consolidated undrained and consolidated drain test were discussed. And the stress paths in triaxial and octahedral plane were introduced and elastic modulus from the triaxial test, how to interpret elastic modulus from triaxial test were discussed. And then we also have solved some couple of worked examples basically to give insight into this module. Which is on stress strain relationship and shear strength of soils. Further, in module 5, the stability of slopes, which is discussed in L40 to L46, that is lecture number 40 to 46. And the stability analysis of a slope and finding critical slip surfaces, sudden drawdown condition, and effective stress and total stress analysis, and seismic displacements in marginally stable slopes. And a concept, or you can say that introduction to reliability based design of the slopes was attempt was made, and in-depth discussion on the methods for enhancing the stability of unstable slopes, this was actually discussed. Basically the methods like slope stabilization by piles and the recent methods like biotechnical stabilization and some methods like stabilization by soil nails and stabilization of a slope by piles, vertical piles. So these stabilization methods were discussed, and basically this in this you know how a what are the different methods of slope stability analysis methods and how these methods can be you know used for determining the factor of safety of a given slope and what are the merits and demerits of different methods which are there in the for analyzing the slope. And also a detailed discussion on the enhancing the stability of unstable slopes was covered. In module 6, a brief discussion on L47 to L49, that is three lectures which was made on buried structures. Basically here a load on pipes and Marston load theory for rigid and flexible pipes and trench and projection conditions were covered and minimum cover pipe flow, minimum cover required and pipe flotation and also liquefaction. Issues were discussed. Interestingly, a recent case study which actually happened in one of the power plant sites was actually discussed and how these you know situations, this type of failure situations can be averted was demonstrated through a GeoStudio 2012 analysis as a case study example. In module 7, finally, a detailed discussion on geotechnical physical modeling was discussed and wherein in principle the lectures run from L50 to L59 where all the you know the aspects which are actually required for geotechnical physical modeling were discussed and wherein physical modeling methods, application of centrifuge modeling and its relevance to geotechnical engineering and the centrifuge modeling of geotechnical structures with actual live examples of centrifuge based physical modeling which is actually activities which are being carried out at IIT Bombay are covered in length and then also an attempt also has been made to bring out the relevance of geotechnical based centrifuge based geotechnical modeling for understanding the behavior of geotechnical structures and for different examples like a slope stability problem and a bearing capacity problem and also like a returning wall problem has been discussed. And then the merits and demerits actually have been awarded. So in this particular course, as we all see, the you know the course is actually very much relevant and has got lot of prominence not only in India but also in many places, many parts of the world. And as far as the India is concerned, where we you know we have got varied you know soil deposits from north to south and east to west in India. Particularly if you look into this, we have alluvial deposits along the rivers, and particularly where we have got river belts, and then we have about 6,300 kilometers of you know coastal belt, and wherein we have about you know the very soft soils, the marine deposits, which are actually having normally consolidated soils throughout the coastal belt. They are there, and majority of the ports and harbor structures are major activities which are actually take place there. They are actually on the on this particular you know marine deposits. And then towards the northern part of India, where we have got the boulder deposits or silt plain areas, which are actually there in Delhi and Uttar Pradesh and other parts of India. And similarly towards the northeast, we actually have got the soils which are of the order of you know some sort of desert soils, and also we have some laterites and lateritic soils. And towards the you know Kerala or this side, we have about the laterite soils again here in this part of the region. And then we have got a you know huge chunk of area which is actually covered with black cotton soil deposits, which actually has got very typical behavior of having the swell shrink behavior. And then we also have you know out of this, if you look into this, there are many areas which are actually classified as vulnerable to you know earthquakes. So the particularly the relevance of you know the soil mechanics or geotechnical engineering has got lot of prominence, because you know some of the techniques which are actually adopted in one region may not be adopted may not be you know applicable in other parts of the country. So there are different challenges which are actually there, like typical challenges in geotechnics. Basically if you look into it, we have the conditions of the roads, particularly on expansive soil deposits in Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra, can cause lot of distress or rutting and other failures. And then with increasing in urbanization, there is a possibility that the municipal solid waste generation actually takes place very rapidly. And this actually has been projected that you know the generation of the municipal solid waste is on the higher side in urban areas. And as on date with unaccounted records, it says that you know 10,000 tons per day is collected in place like Mumbai. And similarly the storage of this waste, if it is not proper, there can be failures like this, which actually can cause you know very you know a situation which is very difficult to manage. And then we have got number of stretches of the long stretches of the railway tracks running on weak formations, and particularly with an increase in the need for you know the increasing the speed of the trains, there is a need for you know arriving at the proper track underlayment structures, wherein you know one of the some of the typical methods which are actually you know modern methods or novel methods which are required to be adopted, so that the fouling of the ballast can be prevented, and also the resistance which is required for the high speed train movement can be ensured by putting some sort of you know a strengthening measure. And similarly we can also think of you know also considering the scarcity of the natural materials, one need to evaluate materials which are actually can be substitutable, like railway embankments which can be constructed with fly ash as a core material, or a coal ash, a coarse coal ash as a coal material, or some reduction in the thickness of the aggregate layer, if you are able to achieve, then there is a possibility that the huge savings can be achieved. In addition to that, particularly in hilly terrain, particularly where the trains run through this several cuttings and embankment sections, there is a possibility that you know these during monsoons, particularly because of the loss of the suction, you know makes it actually to have reduced shear strength, and this makes many slopes to fail. And also have got if these slopes have got huge rock boulders, and there is a possibility that this lead to the dislocation of rock boulders, and which leads to you know failure, as well as you know some of the cases have been reported wherein they end up you know in meeting with the targets, which are actually nothing but the transportation vehicles. And we also have some highway structures where actually because of the flash floods and because of the some instability problems, so there can be unstable sections can be evolved. So this is an example, some of the typical examples which actually show, you know, the requirement of some of the modules which are actually covered. So here it can be seen that a landslide in a Hong Kong area, where you can see that the area which is you know subjected to high rise buildings, and when it is subjected to groundwater table changes within the slope, or if there is a burst of pipeline that can actually create an instantaneous you know ingress of seepage and can create an instability and which can be hazardous, like the way it is actually shown here. So this can actually lead to a distress which actually can create you know the transportation infrastructure can get affected, or also the surrounding or buildings which are actually very close can be badly affected. Similarly, the construction on soft soil, particularly where we have got say a soft ground, if that soft ground is not treated properly, and even if it is the bund is constructed with a proper quality control, but however this type of failures can actually can happen. This is one of the case study which is actually reported in 2006, where you know a reinforced soil wall on a soft clay is subjected to failure because of the distress which is actually reported. A base failure which has been reported, where a 170 meters of section of wall subjected to failure. So these type of things can be averted by a proper understanding about the compressibility and consolidation behavior of a soft soil, and then after adopting an appropriate method, then a superstructure, that is actually a wall, can be constructed on that. This can have a better performance of a structure which can be constructed on such type of soils. And this is a typical you know geogrid reinforced soil wall failure at Seoul, Korea. This actually happened in 2004 after Yu et al. In 2004, and here what actually has happened is that this is called a reinforced soil wall section. This is called reinforced soil zone, and this is called the backfill zone. So here it is generally preferred that you know, at least in the reinforced soil zone, it is preferred that we need to have very you know highly permeable soil. But in case of non-availability, then you know there is an there if you are actually using soil with high percentage of fines, high percentage of fines, in such situations what will actually happen there, that when there is an ingress of water, there will be an increase in positive pore water pressures, and this increases actually the forces in the reinforcement layers, and which was actually not designed for and can lead to failure. So this is one such example, a segmental block failure, wall failure is actually shown here. This is a case which is in 2001, wherein the slope stream instability problems which are actually reported, and this is one of the trains actually met with an accident where which actually lead to the you know a severe rock fall, as well as you know the damage due to slope instability problem. And this is at the similar location, at the same location where close to Ratnagiri station, where we have a typical you know railway embankment failure, where in 2004-5, because of the heavy rain which actually has occurred, and this led to the entire section of a slope of an embankment of about 24 meter subjected to a failure, and wherein you can also see that the restoration methods which are actually have taken place subsequently have also been subjected to failure. And this the track which is actually here, which is shown, was observed to settle in 2005 by about 1.7 meter, subsequently by another 0.8 meter. So in total it actually has sunk by about 2.5 meters, and this actually you know has led to you know several issues, particularly with the instability problems for that cut and fill embankment which was actually constructed at that particular site. And this is a typical slope failures, particularly in the Igatpuri region, where in the monsoon these are actually you know prevalent because of these situations which actually can you know or can be hazardous for the journeys to take place in this direction. So a proper appropriate methods need to be adopted basically to avoid these dangers. And in this you know particularly here in urban areas, particularly when you have got you know the you know gabion walls, and there can be possibility that these gabion walls can undergo deformation. That means that this is the when wall actually moves away from the backfill, you can see that the how the gabion wall deforms. And similarly here when we have got let us say a failure surface actually passes below the retaining wall, then there is no need for this retaining wall, because this retaining wall also will be subjected to failure. So in such situations there is a need for maybe adopting a deep slope stabilization techniques, particularly in these situations can be piled slopes is one, pile or if the retaining wall is provided with the piles, these piles can actually can increase the the slope the factor of safety against the slope stability failure. Similarly, when this is a case study where failure due to excavation in the urban areas, particularly when you are actually doing very close to the property lines, these property lines when the excavation is made, the amount of excavation can cause a distress to the existing structure foundations, like the foundation can be a shallow foundation or a deep foundation, but can lead to eccentric or increasing stresses, and these stresses cause a distress in the existing buildings, and can lead to a collapse of the buildings, because if the proper care or proper protection measures are not taken. This is one such case where the failure actually happened because of the excavation in the area which is actually close to having a 5-storied building. And this is failure of the a dam in Spain, wherein a breaching failure was reported. This is after ICOLD 1995. So this is these type of things can actually lead to a catastrophic dangers of submersion of the flood waters. So these things need to be addressed, because this type of case studies were also reported in New Orleans in 2006 when the when Mississippi River war topped the levee, and it was subjected to entire New Orleans city was actually submerged under water, and this actually caused a lot of destruction. And this is in Singapore, particularly when a particular this is a deep excavation which actually has taken place, and the idea of interest is that this building needs to be protected, and is required to be protected, because any excavation, any change in the groundwater table can lead to settlements in this building. And so here this is a soil nailing type shore protection system was actually adopted basically, and then the surrounding area is gunneted basically to increase the stability and to prevent any loss of support, so that this existing building will not actually experience any distress. So then this also basically this a proper shoring system also allows to adopt and construct a construction in that area where it has been earmarked for development. Similarly, this is a type of shore protection system which is being adopted in India and many places. The piles are actually placed closely, and you can see that these are the beams which are actually connected to anchors. So 3-level anchors were placed. These anchors actually prevent the wall from undergoing rotation. So these anchors will ensure the stability to the this retention system, and then this is actually area which is actually open for development. And this is a famous 35 meter deep Nicolli Highway collapse in Singapore. So this is actually shown, this type of situations can happen when we actually have got the failure of some struts and leading to some retention system or shoring system which actually has been in place. And this is a typical road which is actually shown, but nowadays with the requirement of need for development of underground railway stations or underground networks, there is a need for creating void spaces below the populated areas. So this is if you take a section below, This is actually a underground substation which is actually being developed by a technique which is allows to create void spaces. So these spaces are used basically to maneuver the the trains or underground systems, and these are also nowadays are being used for putting number of underground utilities and communication cables and other accessories. And this is a typical example of cracking of landfill capping system, and this is particularly when the waste which is actually covered and when it is subjected, when the waste beneath the landfill is subjected to some movement because of the ongoing biodecomposition, what actually happened is that the cover system including the liner inside the the lining system inside the cover system is subjected to distress, and is subjected to both desiccation cracks due to drying and wetting which actually takes place, and as well as bending cracks which actually can lead to the loss of integrity and can cause gas migration from the sealed landfill into the surrounding environment. So this is a typical example in France, particularly in area by at Drôme landfill, and this is after Gourc et al 2010. And this is what actually happens is that this is a landfill site in France where you can see that this pipeline is straight at the time of installation, but however after certain period of time you can see that this pipeline undergone non-uniformly settlement. That means that this landfill, what you see is the cover system which actually has got a cover soil which is about 1.2 meters height or so, and then we have got a gas drainage layer, and then we also have got compacted clay liner system, and then there is this is the gas drainage layer, this is water drainage layer. So this water can actually drain out, so that rain water will not enter into the landfill, and then this particular clay barrier can undergo tension because the clay can take only very maybe not more than 1% tensile strain, and once it actually exceeds this tensile strain, the bending exceeds this tensile strain, the material undergoes tensile crack failure, and which leads to the loss of integrity and also leads to the gas migration which actually can take place through the cracks which actually occur because of this deformation. This is the scenario, this if you take the cross section, the cross section may look like this thing. And another typical problem which is possible is that the pollutant migration, like particularly if you are having a pollutant which actually takes let us say a certain amount of time to reach from one destination to other destination, but in order to design barrier systems, particularly vertical barrier systems, one need to adopt proper physical modeling methods so that these systems can be estimated, these can be assessed and ascertained basically, and the methods can be designed with a performance so that this actually lead to a proper functioning of the designed barrier system. So here two examples of, one is that LNAPL migration, the other one is the so called gas migration which is actually shown from a gas tank. So this is another example, this is the blown up view of the this is shown LNPL release and subsequent so when the groundwater table flow, it can lead to the contamination and then it can take away this it can actually promote the migration of LNPL which actually released inadvertently. So the another issues which are actually there in Japan and many other countries is the earthquakes which actually can occur, particularly if you are actually having sandy deposits up to certain amount of fines, there is a possibility that a momentaneous loss of strength can lead to a very rapid settlements. This is a particular photograph where this has been actually taken after the earthquake, where it can be seen that this ground floor now looks higher than the original floor level because what actually has been happened that this shop has undergone settlement and then settled. So you can see that this is the sunken portion of the building. This is the waveside walk which is damaged due to the earthquake, and particularly here these two roads used to be at same level, but because of the distress created due to earthquake, this actually has got experienced a failure. And similarly, when you are actually having a building which is actually designed with on proper foundation system, then they are actually observed to be tallest buildings stands as if nothing happened, but the systems without any proper system can be subjected to a distress, which is actually shown schematically in this particular slide. And another the problem is that the bursting of the underground pipeline, particularly if the pipeline is old or if the pipeline joint failure occurs, and this is actually is very repeatedly happening for the past 3-4 years, and this can actually lead to the destruction which actually shown here, and this is a damage which actually has caused to this area because of the bursting of the underground pipeline. Because here what happens is that these pipelines are operated with certain operation pressures, but with increase in a surge in the pressure, what will happen is that there will be a burst which actually can take place, because the surged pressure cannot be taken by the damaged portion of the pipe or a weak joint. Similarly, this is another example which is a similar trend of failure. You can see the caving of the road due to the bursting of the underground pipeline. The another typical failure which actually shown is that because of the flooding which actually takes place because doing the rivers, and these failure of a bridge pier is actually shown here. You can see that how the pier is actually is about to be displaced. So you can see that the massive effect which is actually shown by the flowing water on the pier which is actually there, which can actually lead to very high amount of scour. So this type of failures can actually occur because this with the loss of confinement can lead to the bearing capacity failure, and can actually have the decks can actually settle like this, and then can lead to failure. So this this is the typical scour problems which are actually shown in number of places, and these are very typical in nature. And this is in 2013 actually which has happened, and the instability problems of the along the hills particularly which actually due to the flash floods and can lead to lot of instabilities and the dangers which actually can happen because of this cloud bursts and other issues which are actually happening in India and other parts of the world. So this is an example where how the destruction actually has taken away the portions of the buildings and led to the severe casualties which actually result from the failures. So this is another look of the destruction which actually has taken place. So you can see that the round boulders, which is actually indicates that the flow of water, which is the history of the flow of water, can be seen from this here. And this is the river which is actually flowing through the flowing along these banks, and this is a typical landslide which actually causes the road to cut off, and a particular number of villages which actually can lead to cut off because of this massive landslides which actually can occur either due to earthquake or due to rainfall or due to some construction activities which are actually taking place in these areas. And this is that power plant conduit failure, wherein you can see that this is before removing the soil, a failed pipeline is shown here, and this is a bean shaped pipeline is actually shown here, and this is this is another pipeline which is intact, but you can see that this pipeline is subject to failure. This is because merely because the flowing water actually exerts very high pressure, and that led to the pipe buckling, which actually has induced this failure. And this is a fire safety water tank in one of the construction sites. So basically this is actually the use area which is actually designed with a concrete lining, it can be seen because of the instability issues, you can see that in with the ingress of rainwater, the amount of the pressure which actually exerted and led to the failure, particularly here in this areas, and the close look of this, you can see that this you know, lining actually experienced a severe failure. And this is a large fire water storage tank. So in this, basically what has actually happened is that how the uplift of the water can actually create a distress can be seen here. The water tank was actually designed for a water table at certain level, but when the water table raises because of the ingress of the water, rainwater, then there is a possibility that what actually happens is that the rainwater exerts a very positive pore water pressure on the base of the tank, and which actually has led to the bending of this slab. You can see that the deformed shape of the slab, and this is a barrier, you know, baffle wall, which actually has been subjected to cracking because the bending is actually is maximum at this particular point. See, this is another instability problem in landfills, particularly when waste undergoes the movements within the landfill, and these lining systems which are actually placed can lead to failures, and which is in a clear example of instability problems in municipal solid waste landfills. And these are the typical you know, schematic figures of the local instability failures, particularly when there is you know, bulging of the liner due to lack of support, then liner actually moves like this, and this can actually lead to failure here. And sometimes what will happen is that if you have got a lining system, but if it is loss of protection due to this is particularly possible when you are actually having geosynthetic clay liners, and when they are subjected to some swell and shrink cycles, and in between they can lose the protected area. So that can actually lead to some sort of a you know, that portion at the zone behaves like as it is unprotected. So this is a typical you know, aerial view of the waste slide, which actually was reported by Ead et al. In 2000, and the lateral displacements are measured to be up to were measured to be up to 275 meters, and vertical displacements up to 61 meters, and 1.2 million meter cube of the waste was actually observed to move. So the lateral displacements up to 300 meters were measured, and vertical displacements were up to 61 meters were observed. And this is another view of you know, reported by Stark et al. 2000, and where you can see that the distressed area, which is of a landfill, is actually shown here. So this is a typical you know, a schematic representation of the failure of ash pond dam. As been discussed, that these ash pond dams are actually designed, you know, this is a method which is actually called as upstream method. The what will happen is that the first bund, which is actually constructed with the you know, the soil, and then the second bund and subsequent third bund and fourth bund, they are actually required to be raised mostly generally in with a bund of 5 meters height, up to 20 meters or 25 meters height. It is the general practice to construct, but because of the non availability of the soil or the need for the use of locally available material like coal ash or fly ash, there is a need for constructing this portion of the first stage or second stage or third stage bund with coal ash, which has a coal ash as a core material, and then surroundings are actually made with you know, a clay blended material, and which actually has got good erosion resistance. So, but you know, when the water, this is a big hydraulic structure, when the water exerts a pressure, there can be possibility that this type of instability failures can result because of the seepage problems, and these type of problems are also you know, can occur when you are actually having even tailings dams or coal ash pond dams. This particular slide, which actually shows the problems which actually can come with high speed trains, and this is from you know, Tokyo Institute of Technology, wherein in Japan they have investigated about the effect of movement of high speed trains on the and the bridge pier foundations, and particularly when the high speed train traverses on the bridge, and the bridge which is actually resting on the you know, say sandy soil, and these bridge piers are subjected to localized liquefaction, and then these vibrations are actually sometimes if the piers are closed then there can be interference can actually take place. So in order to study these problems, particularly like how these damages can be prevented and to allow the traversing of high speed trains, then there is a need for the so called adoption of isolation systems. So in order to design these systems with performance and all, then geotechnical based physical model studies, particularly especially the centrifuge based physical model study can be used. So this is in recently which actually happened along Mumbai Pune expressway in June 2015, wherein because of the instability of the rock slopes, there can be a problem which is actually can cause because of the instability occurs due to the detachment of the rock pieces, and led to the number of casualties also. And these to avoid these things, the proper system need to be in place. So this is actually being discussed to bring the awareness about the magnitude and order of the problems which are actually there in the advanced geotechnical engineering arena. Similarly, with an increase in urban population, with generation of the urban waste, there is a need for proper disposal of the waste. For example, this is a scenario in some mega cities, but if these waste is actually confined properly, and this can lead to generation of good gas which actually can be used for producing at least to electricity to support the landfill activities. These to be handled properly, and apart from whatever the methods which are actually adopted to reduce the waste, but there is ultimately there is landfills are the ultimate disposal methods which are actually for disposing the waste. So these are the typical examples how they can actually lead to the order of contaminants which actually can occur. And this can be seen that this type of areas can have the serious effect on the adjoining properties, and the generation of the gases can lead to the environmental hazards and contamination of the water bodies beyond the high toxic levels. So these need to be done with this comes under the environmental geotechnical area. And connecting to the very recent developments, nowadays which is required to have not only you have a foundation, but also the foundation which actually has to also takes supports the cooling and heating systems within the buildings. So these are actually the part of the green buildings or proper green buildings which are actually coming up. So energy pile, which is nothing but a foundation, and which is basically differs from the conventional pile foundation because it is actually subjected to both mechanical as well as thermal loads. So thermal loads means it can be this coupled loading condition basically highlights the need to have a clear understanding about the temperature effects on the mechanical behavior of soil as well as the pile soil interaction. So what will happen when you're actually having a different temperatures on the interfaces, and what actually happens on the in the pile soil interface, and similarly what is the effect of the temperature on the mechanical behavior of the soils need to be understood. So these energy piles concept is actually proving to be you can see that this is in the winter and this is in the summer. So wherein it actually used in winter, it is used to heating the building, and in summer it is used to cooling the building. So this is a new concept which is actually been reported by Abiol Naga et al in 2015. So this advanced geotechnical engineering area, which is actually has got multifaceted interest, particularly from environmental engineering point of view, from the transportation engineering point of view, or from the structural engineering point of view, to actually have construct these high rise buildings, one need to understand about the compressibility, consolidation, and stress strain behavior of a soil, and from the performance point of view, in order to understand the behavior, all these aspects which are actually sometimes when the proper materials are not available, when the need for the optimization of the designs, when we wanted to improve the performance of the design, and then you know, then we actually need to retort to the appropriate physical modeling methods, and these methods which actually can lead to a betterment in the behavior. So, but not all geotechnical failures end up in embarrassment, however most do. This is a famous example of Leaning Tower Pisa in Italy, which is you know 400 to 500 year old, and which is subjected to a sort of distress because of the consolidation or compression behavior of a clay. So, before giving the references, you know, at the outset, the I would like to thank for patient hearing, and I would also like to thank the Center for Distance Education Program and NPTEL Phase 2 staff for their excellent support and motivation provided for completing this course from time to time. So, for giving feedback on this course, please contact myself, which is actually written here, Dr. Ing BVS Vishwanathan, Professor, Department of Civil Engineering, Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay, India, and the telephone number and email ID, which is actually given here. And this is the iconic symbol of Gyanam Paramam Dheyam of IIT Bombay. So, now the some of the references which are actually used in this particular course are given here, and these references are not in order, but number of references were actually used. So, this majority of the references are listed here, and if any of the references are missed, they are actually missed only from inadvertently, where could not be added. But here you know Atkinson 2007 Mechanics of Soils and Foundations, and Das 2008 Advanced Soil Mechanics, Craig RF 2004 Craig Soil Mechanics, and the some of the references which are actually given here, they are actually Holz and Kovacs Introduction to Geotechnical Engineering, which was actually referred, McCarthy Essentials of Soil Mechanics and Foundations and Basic Geotechnics, and Parry RHG, this is basically for bore circles, stress paths and geotechnics were actually referred for you know shear strength characteristics of soil, and Wood David Muir Wood actually book is actually was basically referred for some examples and discussions which are actually made on geotechnical physical modeling and centrifuge based physical modeling. So, the geotechnical modeling aspects were actually covered from this particular you know book, and the basic soil mechanics book Lambie and Whitman 1969 soil mechanics book with John Willey, which was actually used, and these are some of the cross references which are actually shown here, and then these are some of the references which are actually listed in the literature or which are referred or indicated here, and these are the some references Tarjagi and Lambie and Whitman, and you know then this the theoretical soil mechanics by Tarzaghi 1943, this was referred for some of the in the derivations, and then Taylor 1948 fundamentals of soil mechanics, this was actually referred, and theoretical foundation engineering by Das 1987 was actually referred, and then again Harza, particularly for in the seepage analysis, uplift and seepage under the dams in sand, this was actually referred, and then MER groundwater and seepage, this was actually referred for discussing about the seepage relevant aspects in the particular module. Then these are the some references which are actually listed in this particular lectures. So, this is you know in slope stability computations according to John Boos method, and this is for Fellnius method, and then you know we also have covered you know the different this is a GeoStudio 2012 and the excellent software package for calculating the slope stability and CW, and also for stress strain behavior of sigma W for loading conditions, this was used. and also QuakeW was also used for simulating some problems on earthquake aspects. And then these are the some references: Kai and Ugai 2003, response of flexible piles under laterally linear movement of the sliding layer in landslides. And this, while discussing pile stabilized slopes, was actually referred. And landslides analysis and control, this is again under slope stability aspects and stabilization methods were actually discussed. Abramson, this is for Abramson et al. 2002 was referred for slope stability and stabilization methods, which is after John Willey and Sons. And then some of the books which are actually referred, or papers which are referred, are listed here. And this is again the Kramer, which is on geotechnical earthquake engineering, was actually referred for discussing about the you know, the seismic aspects of the slopes. And then in the geotechnical physical modeling, Jellickson 1969 was actually referred for geotechnical models using hydraulic gradient similarity method. And then Barden 1965, this is here consolidation of clay with nonlinear viscosity, and this is actually referred in from geotechnic. And then there are number of references which are actually listed here, which are actually shown here for the and then the ground geotechnical engineering ground handbook, that is geotechnical engineering handbook, that is Grunbaum board mechanic Taschen book, was actually referred for some salient examples, which are actually documented by Professor Smolcik. Part 3 and part 5 were referred. And in case of buried conduits, Handy, loads on underground conduit soil engineering, and Handy and Spangler geotechnical engineering soil foundation principal practice, which actually referred particularly for Handy, was referred for the worked examples, and then theory which is actually relevant to buried conduits or buried structures. And then in some of the lectures, these are actually Spangler and Handy soil engineering, this book was referred, and this is another references. And this is on the consolidation settlement due to ramp loading, this was actually referred after Shukugan et al. 2014. And these are the some of the references which are actually listed, which are shown here. This is in soft ground improvement. So for you know, more details that and feedback on this course, the details can be obtained here at this address, which is actually shown here. This marks the end of advanced geotechnical engineering course. And this course also supported by you know, the worked examples and some exercises which are actually done already in the slides, are also going to be provided, basically to show more you know, interest in the subject, and also to also gain you know, practice and experience in solving some typical problems. And these problems are actually mostly practical oriented, so that and this can lead to lot of insight into the subject on advanced geotechnical engineering. Thank you very much for patient listening.